bisa
PPT-nya bisa
ah cukup ya kan macet dia tapi macet tidak dari kita macet luar biasa lagi. Bisa mulai
right, ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention? The presentation is about to begin. Then assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning, participants and also speakers. Happy Sunday. Welcome to webinar of EIEN Curug, help conducted by English Franca Journals and also cooperated with TBI, EIEN Curug, and also E-Station. And our team today is Avoiding Plagiarism. So allow me to say thank you for the honorable speakers and also participants who are joining here today. So I would like to remind you that today is our last presentation and last webinar. Tomorrow we're gonna distribute your certificate through your email. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to introduce you our speakers today. She is Mrs. Arina Istiana M. Hum from Sanata Dharma University. And our topic today is all about avoiding plagiarism in writing journal, of course. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to remind you to switch off your audio during the presentation and also during the webinar. Ladies and gentlemen, if you want a certificate, it's better for you to attend to the group chat and also write down your name to the group chat. Do not leave the presentation. If you leave the presentation, we will not send the certificate to your email. Thank you. Webinar will be running around 40 minutes, 50 minutes. We give a big chance to the presentation for the speakers and 50 minutes more for question and answer. And the last 10 minutes, it will be closing. And ladies and gentlemen, to shorten our time, we'll give a valuable time to Bu Arina Istiana SPDM Hum from Sanata Dharma University to present the materials about avoiding plagiarism. Line is yours, ma'am.
Okay, thank you very much for the host. Good morning, everybody. So thank you, EIEN Curug, for inviting me to be the speaker of this webinar. And in this occasion, I would like to present about the avoiding plagiarism in thesis or journal writing. I use one of the books about plagiarism in thesis or journal writing. Can you show the next slide? The second slide, please. Okay, so I take the materials from Macmillan and Weyers, entitled How to Cite, Reference, and Avoid Plagiarism at University. You can find the book yourself on if you think that my presentation is not really clear and you think that you need to dig more on the concept of plagiarism. The third slide, please. Uh, Okay, so before talking about what plagiarism is and how to avoid it, it is better for me to review first about the academic writing. You are university students, we are lecturers, we are, what's that? It is obligatory for us to write articles, journal, right, or thesis academically. And why should we write an academic writing? It is very important for us to write academically because we need to use our language effectively in communicating our ideas and also to communicate the ideas of others because we have to read a lot. Yeah. So when we make a thesis, when we write a journal article, it is impossible for us not to read other people's work. And what is important over here is that our topic has to be supported by others. It is to show that we already learned something. We want to show the gap research that we find in the current research. So it is important for us to quote, it is important for us to cite, and it is important for us to use our language effectively to communicate what is actually our goal in this thesis. What is actually our objective of this journal article? Therefore, to cite sources and how cite sources properly is very important to success as an academic author. I noticed that some journals, maybe English Franca also has this kind of rules. We have to fulfill particular number of references in a journal article or in a thesis. It is to show that you already read the current research. You already learned that your topic is, it's important to conduct. Because when we have a research, we cannot pick the topic randomly, right? We have to show that our is worth studying. Our topic is important to conduct. Therefore, it is very important to understand the goal of academic writing. The next slide, please. Okay, so what is plagiarism? Plagiarism means to claim others' work as their own property, and it is called as the intellectual property because we claim other people's idea, we claim other people's work as our own. Therefore, it is not allowed in academic writing. So as academic writers, we must attribute the ownership of ideas, texts, and other forms of work of the original writers. So we should provide the source, whose idea it is, where did you get the data, where did you get the theory, yeah? So we have to put the references, the original writers in citation. Next, please. There are some types of plagiarism we have learned from the book. The first is minor plagiarism. So in minor plagiarism, what happens is that we take a small sentence or a short paragraph of another manuscript that is plagiarized without any significant data or idea. It means that you just randomly take the sentence that is not really significant to your findings, but again, it is not yours. It is other people's work, right? So you take a small sentence, a short paragraph that is not really significant actually, but you do not write and cite properly. Therefore, it is categorized into minor plagiarism. The second type is intermediate plagiarism. What happens over here is that you take a significant data, paragraph or a sentence of an article without proper citation. What is meant by proper citation over here is that sometimes you only write the author's name and you forgot to put the year of publication. If you make a direct quotation, you forgot to mention the page, right? Therefore, it is an intermediate plagiarism. It also happens when you already take a significant data, paragraph, or sentence in your journal article, but you forgot to mention the reference. Therefore, it is an intermediate plagiarism. The last type of plagiarism is severe plagiarism. It means that you take a large portion of an article that involves many aspects, such as reproducing original results. It can be the data, formulation, equation, law statement, etc. And you also reproduce the ideas, method in other publications. It is okay to use the same methodology as other people's work. It's okay. For example, you conduct a descriptive qualitative method. You have theory of that, right? And a lot of research about descriptive qualitative. The problem over here is that you directly take the same paragraph as the other paper, you put it into yours. Therefore, it will be categorized into severe plagiarism. What you have to do is that there are a lot of references about descriptive qualitative method. Therefore, what you have to do is to find other references, right? Other people's work to get inspired, right? But you have to use your own your journal article writing. Therefore,
banyak di kamera kocaknya kok.
Excuse me, sorry for bothering your presentation, ma'am. So I would like to remind for all of participants to switch off the audio, please. For the all participants to switch off your audio, please. Thank you. All right, ma'am, you can continue your presentation. Thank you.
Okay, the next slide, please. Yeah, okay. So this is an example of severe plagiarism that I check using Turnitin. Right, so in this case, the writer take the same paragraph about the theory of semiotics, directly copy and paste of what is written book to her journal article. Therefore, it is categorized into severe plagiarism. So in this case, it will be detected directly by Turnitin because in a journal checker tool, and this is one of the tools that is familiar in Indonesia. So this kind of way is not permitted in academic writing. Therefore, when you try to review the theory, you have, so this is an example that is often found in the student's thesis and also in journal articles. So this way permitted in academic. The next slide. Slide 7. Okay, so what is the reason or what are the reasons of avoiding plagiarism? So first, because we need to maintain our academic integrity. Academic integrity over here refers to honesty. Yeah. So how attribution to sources? And the second reason is that we need to demonstrate our critical thinking skill. It means that our ability to analyze complex information. I will introduce you the two basic skills to avoid plagiarism. The next slide. Okay, so the first skill is clear citations and references. The second skill is summary and paraphrase. So I will on skills today. So tonight means to use a phrase or sentence from piece of writing or speech, especially in order to support or something, to mention a particular writer or piece of work while using our own words. Okay, let's discuss one by one. The next slide. The next slide, please. Okay, so remember in my previous slide that in clear citations and references, we need to develop our critical thing, our critical thinking. What does it mean? It means that we need to evaluate opinion and systematically, clearly, and with purposes to make careful judgment after balanced consideration of all aspects of a topic. So whenever we read a journal article as our reference, we do not take the articles randomly. You must have a reason. Why do you take this journal article into your previous study? It doesn't mean that you can take the articles, the more articles you take, it will make your papers, sophisticated. But it will depend on how critical you review the previous studies. Yeah. Therefore, we have to evaluate often. It is not only to fulfill the number of references, but you have to question yourself first whether the quotation strengthens my discussion or not. For example, when you discuss the implementation of blended learning in a particular class, right? Therefore, you will find the journal articles talking about blended learning, right? But you have to question whether this article is really important to my discussion or not. For example, you have to choose whether you take the previous study of blended learning in university students or in primary school environment, right? Therefore, you have to question that yourself. Which one is the most related to your research? If you want to research the effect of blended learning for university students, for example, therefore, it is suggested for you to find the study of blended learning in university level 2. Or if you want to compare how blended learning affects the students in high school environment and university environment, therefore you are okay to quote or to put the previous study of blended learning in high school environment. The second question is that you have to question yourself whether the extract place special emphasis on my findings or viewpoint. If you think that this article does not support my discussion later on, therefore you can leave it out. And the third, you have to question whether the words used make the author's point in a particular powerful way that would be weakened if paraphrased. It means that sometimes it is okay for us to cite directly. It is okay for us to take directly the sentences from other works, right? To question whether if I paraphrase it with my own words, will it reduce the author's point of view or not? If it doesn't reduce the author's point of view, so it is suggested to use paraphrase. Let me give you an example. The next slide, please. Slide 10, yeah. Okay, this is an example of how we conduct a citation, yeah. In my first example, this is a direct citation. It means that the writer does not change the words from the book or from the journal article. There are some requirements. The requirements are, first, you have to use the quotation marks in the sentence that you directly take from the book or journal article. The second rule is that you have to mention the author's last name in brackets followed by the year and page. Over here, I refer to APA citation style. So an example over here, in linguistic study, style refers to, what does it refer to? So I take the definition as it is from the book. Therefore, I start with a quotation mark. Selection from a total linguistic repertoire that constitute a style. So over here, I do not change anything from the book. The second example is that what we have over here is not a direct quotation. It means that the writer already paraphrased what the book says. The writer already paraphrased it. Therefore, you can find that there aren't any quotation marks in the second example. The third example over here is also a direct quotation. We can see that we have quotation marks followed by author's name, year, and page. If you have more than three words, therefore, the way you show the citation will be different because you have to use indented paragraph, no quotation marks, source provided with a page number. The host, can you please go directly to slide 12? Yeah, this one. This one is what we have as direct quotation or block quotation whenever it contains of more than 40 words. If the quotation is less than 40 words, you can use quotation marks and put it in the paragraph. But if you have more than 40 words, it means that you have to show the paragraph or sentences in indented format. This is the example. For example, ideology is an elaborate story told about the ideal conduct of blah, blah, blah until the end. So over here, we have more than 40 words. Therefore, the sentences are put in indented format. You have to mention the author's last name, year, and what page. Remember, if you have direct quotation, you must always provide the page number. But if you paraphrase it, you can leave out the page number, but again, you must write the author's last name and also year. The next slide. About the references. Yeah. Okay, so in the first skill, you have to pay attention to the publication details of the references. The first is that you have to pay attention to the authors. Are the authors there or not? And then you have to check the year of publication. If you have a book, you also have to pay attention to the name of the publisher and city of publication, and of course the title of the book. If you want to cite from a journal article, you have to be careful. You have to question whether this source is reliable or not. A reliable source will have title, the name of the journal article, what volume, what issue, page number, and nowadays you have the DOI. So to help you manage the references, I suggest to use Mendeley and Zotero. The speakers already presented the use of Mendeley, and I agree with the speaker that it's very helpful for us to manage our references. The next slide. Slide 14. Okay, so this is the second skill that you have to master in avoiding the plagiarism. Second skill is to summary and to summarize and to paraphrase. So summary means to retell the concept or ideas of the author source in a shorter with your own. Because this is to summarize, of course, we have to make it in a shorter way, once only. But remember, in summary, you mention the source, the original source. Even though you already summarize it with your own words, again, this is not your ideas, right? This is still other people's ideas. So put the last name of the author and then what year. In summarize, we also use our own words to give general ideas. So summarize the general ideas only. We have to state the main points briefly. And we should include the views of the original author, but giving less detail than in paraphrase. This is what makes summary and paraphrase different. In summary, you only need to show the general points, but in paraphrase, you have to retain the key points, the idea of the original author, but you have to clarify it. It is different from summary. Right? So in paraphrase, you can make two sentences into one, or you can make one original sentence from the author into two sentences because you need to clarify the concept. In summary, you have to make it short. Yeah, one journal article can be summarized into one or two paragraphs, right? In paraphrase, the point is not to make it shorter. Paraphrase, the point is that you retell what happens, you retell the key ideas, you clarify the meanings of people's ideas with your own words. And the viewpoint over here is from the original author. Next slide, please. Okay, there are some practical tips for summarizing and paraphrasing. The first is that you have to make it simple. You have to keep it simple. If you take the example from linguistic books, for example, yeah, the books sometimes are difficult to understand with the sophisticated language over there. Therefore, it is your job to make it simple. This is your job to make it understandable by the readers. And the second tip is that you have to observe the copyright. Again, even though you use your own words, right? But what you present is not your ideas. Therefore, you have to observe the copyright. You have to mention the author's name, what year of publication, and then what page. And the third is that you have to be objective. If you disagree with the author's idea, it is okay. Yeah, you should not only take the journal articles or the sources that agree with you. Yeah, because one of the purposes of conducting academic writing is that we can compare. Yeah, we can compare the previous research to our research. How are they different? Therefore, we need to be objective. If you disagree with a topic, it is okay. Just present it because you should not and you may not change the point or the key idea of the previous study. And the third is you have to avoid sentence juggling. And the last is you have to revisit some of the literature to identify balance in use of quotation, summarizing, and paraphrasing. What does it mean? It means that if you do not really understand what the writer means, you can find other researchers talking about similar topic. And you can compare whether the concept presented in the first journal article is the same as the second and the third articles. Therefore, you will summarize it easier and better. Let me give you an example of summary and paraphrase in slide 16. Yeah, so this is the example of summary and paraphrase. The original text over here contains of 51 words, right? So over there in summary, you can find that one paragraph is summarized into a sentence. Yeah, the original text is very long. It contains of 51 words. Yeah, let us read. Books are a function of the internet era and make access to otherwise unattainable material possible to wider audiences. The globalization of literature means that individual authors can present their work to a wider audience without incurring abortive publication costs. This facility constitutes a considerable threat to publishers of traditional books. Yeah, so this is the original text. And what is the summary result? With the advent of ebooks, individual authors are faced with new approaches to publication of their work. This is very short. So over here, the concept is already presented, but it is in general way. It is different from paraphrased text. What can we find over there? Over here, let us read the paraphrased text. What notes that there is a concern amongst publishers of hard copy printed books that the advent of ebooks marks the end of the monopoly of the literature market, since authors can publish directly from the internet, thus avoiding publishing costs.
Sorry,
so, ma'am. In paraphrase,
sorry we for find interrupting, ma'am.
The details. Sorry. Oh, okay.
Sorry for interrupting. Yeah, we have only 1 minute more, and then we go to question and answer. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, so this will be the last slide that I presented.
All right.
So in paraphrase over here, you find the important points such as hard copy printed books. You have the point of monopoly. You have point of literature. You also have the point of publishing cost. Therefore, paraphrase will be more detailed than summary. Okay, I think I make myself clear. If you have any question, maybe we can continue. To the moderator, I will return the floor to you. Thank you.
All right. Thank you for the interesting presentation, ma'am. Now we go to question and answer. Mm-hmm. We have one question here, ma'am. Bagaimana pendapat? Excuse me.
Okay.
Wait. Bagaimana pendapat presenter tentang sebuah artikel yang banyak citasinya dibandingkan ide atau gagasan sendiri? This is the first question for Andy Mustafa. Okay.
Okay. Okay, thank you. Mas Andy, hello, how are you? How about Alma? Okay, so I understand your question. So first, we have to distinguish our own ideas and other people's idea. I not say that the more references you have, the better your writing is. No, it depends on how you quote or how you put the citation. Is it only to fulfill or to make your article long, or is it really to help you? Is it really to help you improve your discussion? Sometimes, or not sometimes, it is a must for us to show the novelty of our research. Therefore, in the introduction, for example, we have to show the previous researches. We have a lot of researches of, for example, blended learning, right? But how to show the readers that your research is different from them? It means they have to show many examples of blended learning, and you have to show the gap of your research. What is the gap that is still there? For example, the gap is that blended learning in English letters or English literature environment. There are a lot of blended learning research to, for example, education department, to primary school, high school, etc. But blended learning for literature students, for example, when you teach poetry, what happens there? Therefore, it is something that you have to show the difference. So my research is different from them, therefore it is important. So it depends on the way you write, right? It depends on the way you write. Of course, you have to give your own ideas, yeah? But sometimes our ideas have to be supported by other literature. It is to show that our argument is strong. So that is the purpose actually. So the purpose of including a lot of references is to show that our ideas are strong. Yeah. How can we know that our ideas are strong? Because there are already published works talking about our ideas too. Yeah. Therefore, you can conclude later on whether your findings support the previous studies or whether your findings against the previous study. That is the importance of the review of previous studies. Maybe I hope I
All right. Participant Mutmaina Mursidin, the last you have written your questions, but unfortunately we have a disconnection here. So can you replay your questions? Thank you. All right, ma'am, do you hear my voice? Ma'am Arina, do you hear my voice?
Can you hear my voice? Yeah. Yes, can you hear my voice too?
Right. Yeah, we have a question here from Rita Indrawati Dudi, if I'm not mistaken. So when will we decide to paraphrase and to summarize? Which one is easier? Okay. This is the question.
Thank you for the question.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Ibu Rita, for the question. Let me answer the question. So we decide to paraphrase and to summarize depends on whether you want to show the general report of a particular topic or whether you want to show the detail of a particular results or a particular topic. Therefore, it depends on the text that you create. If you want to show the result of the previous study, for example, in the introduction, we just need to show the importance of research. We just need to show the gap of our research with the previous studies. Therefore, what we have to do in introduction only to summarize. The previous studies, of course, you should not only sum, you also need to paraphrase because you have to show the detail of what happened in the previous research. For example, you have to mention the methodology, you have to mention findings, you have to mention the discussion, and you have to mention the implication of the previous research. So it will depend on the text that you read and the purpose, whether you want to cite in the introduction part or the review of literature part. I think I cannot answer the second question, which one is easier. So whether it is easy or not depends on whether we practice it or not. Some people will say that to summarize is more difficult because you have to find out the general concept of the text. But some people say that paraphrase is more difficult because you have to pay attention to the detail that we cannot leave out. Therefore, will depend on the people. That is the answer from Memrita's question.
Because the question from Mutmaina, it is already, you know, answered by the presenters. And the next question is, bagaimana menghindari self plagiarism, how to avoid self-plagiarism. Seberapa banyak boleh kita menyitasi artikel kita sendiri dalam artikel baru kita. That's the second question, ma'am. The last question, I mean. Hello?
Okay, thank you. Plagiarism, yeah. So in self-plagiarism, actually we can include our own previous writings, but only include one or two research in an article, because we mention a lot of our publications, it will be a bit narcissistic, I guess, right? And it will not be regarded as plagiarism as long as you put the source. Yeah. So you have to keep in your mind first that what is the concept of plagiarism? It is to take somebody's ideas because it is our own idea. Sometimes our language will be similar, right? Sometimes our language will be similar. Therefore, it is very important to improve our our skill in paraphrase. We have to enrich our vocabulary. Sometimes we can make two publications from one thesis, but you have to again show the difference between the first publication and the second publication. So I think academically it's okay for us to cite our own works around one or two articles, but if you quote more than one or two, therefore, what is the significance of your study? Why don't you compare your study from others? How to make it significant? How to show that your research is significant enough to others? I know it answers the question.
All right, that is the last question, ma'am. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, actually, finally, we come to the end of our seminar here, webinar. We would like to say thank you for the presenter, the Honorable Ibu Arina Istiana, SPDM Hum, from Sanata Dharma University. The theme is Avoiding Plagiarism. So big thanks for the presentation, for the interesting presentation, actually. So, and also all of audience, we would like to say thank you for your active participation here. Hopefully the presentation will be beneficial for everyone. Thank you for your attention. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. And then we hope that we can make a new meeting for the another team. Thank you.